Welcome to Sacred Stream Radio with Isa Gucciardi. Today, Isa discusses the relevance of ritual in contemporary society.
The first thing I want to say about rituals is that they provide pathways between one world and another. And generally speaking, they provide transitions or access or change in the environment. And there are many types of rituals. There's the kinds of rituals that you might have getting up in the morning that help you transfer your consciousness from sleeping consciousness to waking consciousness. Probably, if you think about it, you probably have a pretty regular kind of practice that you do when you get up. You may, put on your glasses in a particular way because you left them in the exact same place you always leave them. You may pick up a robe and put it on in a particular way. You may go have a drink of water with the same glass in the same place. That's a ritual that helps transfer your consciousness from one place to another. And you might think about kinds of rituals that you might have when you come home from work that would help you create a shift from your working consciousness into a non-working engagement with the world. Maybe a relaxation, it's a time for relaxation or study or something else. And all kinds of rituals have a habitual repeating activity to them. And this habitual repeated activity is designed to put us in contact with a new form of engagement with the world. And these habits or rituals that I'm talking about right now are those that we engage with in our everyday kind of mundane existence. There are other types of rituals that are less effective or less positive rituals around habits that give relief from a situation that's hard to cope with, but do not transform the problem. Things like smoking or some other kinds of mild engagement with substances that would change our state of consciousness have a ritual around them. Of course, drug use that is of a more intense nature, say heroin or crack or some other kind of drug that really separates you from your body or from your environment, have their own rituals around them that send you into a place that is not so helpful. But the place that I really want to focus on this evening is rituals which help us bring the divine into our usual way of being. And I think that most of us are probably focused on rituals, especially this time of year, from that perspective. And in order to really go into understanding the pathways that rituals create between the fields of energy which might be considered or understood to be divine in nature, and I think everyone has their own definition of what divine is, I'm going to offer a paradigm which is drawn from shamanism, which would hopefully be applicable to anyone's definition of the divine. And to point to that, I'd like to talk about what Carlos Castaneda calls ordinary reality and non-ordinary reality. And ordinary reality is the reality that most of us live our lives in. It's the reality where we wake up in the morning and go to work and go out for a date, get married, have babies, have a process of aging that brings us into death. And that's our life. That's ordinary reality. And non-ordinary reality, in terms of as general a definition as I can provide, is one where there is a field of activity that lies under this material level that we normally inhabit and which we normally call our lives, our daily lives. And this field of non-ordinary reality is, in shamanic terms, understood to be the place that people in ordinary reality can access the divine through. And so I'd like to just point to places that are most commonly understood to be access points to this non-ordinary reality in most people's lives. And of course, this is generally the place that religion fills in most people's lives. Churches or temples are places where most of us encounter the type of ritual that is supposed to put us into contact with the divine power that's held in non-ordinary reality. And the problem that people have encountered, you know, this crisis of faith that has occurred in the last 30 years, where organized religions have, in the traditional sense, have really kind of lost their meaning for many people. I'm just talking here in the United States. There has really been an increase in this flight away from looking to churches as providing the kinds of rituals that people feel sustained by in terms of being connected to the divine through the rituals that the church is providing. In Europe, of course, this happened a long time ago. Europe is much more secular than the United States. And of course, you could look at each culture and see how relevant the dominant religious system is to the individuals in that culture. And it would be very interesting. The problem in the West, which I'm going to speak to because most of us are here in the United States and the Western world, is that the rituals that are in the churches are ones that are based on the reporting of direct experience of spirit that one or two people had 3,000 years ago or 4,000 years ago. And they have become a little bit solidified. And the rituals that are designed to try to bring forth the kind of power that one or two people had, like Moses had, or that Jesus taught about, for instance, in Christianity, the pathways for accessing that power have become rigid. And also, the context is not really relevant today. People are not living in the desert, wandering in the desert. They are not living in a monarch that is going to try to wipe out their belief structures. We're living in a very different context. And so the rituals that we would engage in order to be able to access the divine are bound to be different. And yet we're using these same rituals today. And this concretization that sets in becomes a problem because people no longer really experience the divine when these rituals are performed because of this lack of congruence in context. When the ritual loses its significance and when the pathways that ritual creates become rigid or concretized, the divine aspect that people are trying to access becomes inaccessible. And you're left with a kind of rote repetition of the ritual where people are going through the motions but not experiencing any personal contact with the divine. So I wanted to talk about how to make rituals fresh and personal for you and your life. So for instance, Krista, you're talking about wanting to create a ceremony in your house. And I think that one of the first things that's important to define when you're creating a ritual is, what are you trying to bring into your environment? What is your definition of the divine, or what is your definition of whatever it is you're trying to bring into the ritual that you're performing? So for instance, let's say you're having a house blessing. What is the energy that you want to bring in, or what is the power that you want to bring in to the house to create the blessing? Do you want it to have the kind of power that is held in the hearth? Do you want to have the kind of power that is held in a garden? What is the nature of the energy that you want to bring forth in performing the ritual? And so to think about what that would be, it's helpful to develop methods for connecting with the energy that you want to bring into the material plane or ordinary reality. And if we're talking about developing a connection with the divine, there are certain things that you can do that would help you connect with your understanding of the divine, or even help you articulate what your understanding of the divine is. And those kinds of things are walking in nature or sitting in nature, engaging in some creative project, creating some kind of art or music, or learning different methods of prayer or meditation that have meaning to you and that are personal to you, that are not mediated by some external definition of what the divine is. So to really personalize your understanding of what it is that you want to bring forward through the ritual. And as you engage in this process, if any of you have had any kind of disruption in your relationship to the divine because you had a different understanding of the divine than either socially sanctioned or externally defined channels of definition that were provided to you through rituals that had no intrinsic meaning to you, you might feel that you need to kind of clear out the disruption that these kinds of externally generated rituals might have created for you in order to really be able to access these fields of energy that have more meaning to you on a personal level. And so if that does come up, don't be surprised. It's all part of the process of really helping yourself articulate what is important to you. And then as you become more engaged with these aspects of the divine, for instance, again, I'm just using the divine because it's usually the most commonly accessed power that ritual is designed to access. So if you were to bring forward your ability to connect with the divine in your own way, you can listen and you can try to understand what would be the ritual that would bring this power through. And it's surprising to understand that, for instance, if your understanding of the divine is found in nature, that you, as you're listening and trying to understand your connection, you may be drawn to a stone that you might bring from that your favorite place in nature, and you might bring into the room that you're creating the ritual. That might be something that you would do. You may suddenly feel the desire to dance as you're there in nature, and then you might want to bring that dance into the room where you want to create an environment of the divine. Or you may hear a song in your prayer or in your meditation, and you may decide to sing that song to transfer again that power of the divine into the room. And pretty soon you have a ritual that you are creating to help open the pathways between the divine and the unseen aspects that are held in non-ordinary reality that might support your endeavor, whatever you're trying to create the ritual for. And then you'll find that the ritual that you engage in has personal meaning to you, and that you're able to be engaged with the power that's coming through the ritual in a very fresh and meaningful way. And I think this is something that we can all do. This is not something that just priests can do or that just shamans can do. It's something that all ordinary people can do to help revitalize the connection with the powers that are held in non-ordinary reality so that our experience in ordinary reality becomes more meaningful.
Thanks for listening to Sacred Stream Radio, brought to you by Red Cow Records and the Foundation of the Sacred Stream. For more information on our training programs, classes, and free events, please visit us on the web at sacredstream.org. The Foundation of the Sacred Stream is a nonprofit organization building consciousness and community.